that you would be mindful of us. What do you see that's worth looking our way? We are free in ways that we never should be. Sweet relief from the grip of these chains. Like hinges straining from the weight, my heart no longer can keep from singing. Is calling. altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. As you wait for the crown, tell the world of the treasures you found. Amen. You can have a seat.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Grace Bible Church of Phoenix. It was awesome worshiping with you all this morning. Want to go through a few things that are coming up in the fall as we have a large menu of ministries and special events that are coming up shortly. I would like to, large menu. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. First of all, if you have, if this is your first time here or one of your first times here, I have a couple announcements specifically for you. There are some connection cards in front of you. So if you'd like to be made aware of the things that are going on at church, our prayer list and our prayer email chain, please fill that out. You can drop it in the offering box on your way out. We can stay in touch with you that way. Also, something that was a large part of our ministry here and something that was some of my favorite things that we did, myself and Pastor Josh, the first Sunday of every month, we used to do a New Here, Eat Here. And I don't know if you've been paying attention, but the world kind of fell apart about 8 months ago. And so we haven't been doing that in a while, but we're glad to start offering that again. So If in the last 6 months you have started to attend or make this your church home, or you're just visiting and are trying us out, we would like to have lunch with you after next Sunday, the November the 2nd, and about 10 minutes afterwards, we'll just grab a bite to eat, a time of sharing, getting to know each other, and you get to ask any questions, and we look forward to seeing you there. Also, Trunk or Treat is happening Saturday, October 31st, during Halloween. We have 15 trunks already signed up. We had 10 last year, and it was a blast. We're going for 20 this year. There's still a sign-up sheet in the foyer behind. There's some pictures of some epic trunks and costumes here behind me. So we look forward to seeing you all there, whether you are decorating a trunk for the trunk or treat, or you are just bringing your family for a good time of trick-or-treating. We look forward to seeing you there October 31st. The senior luncheon is this Wednesday at noon. Sign-up is in the foyer. I will not be there because I'm not old enough, but if you are old enough to be considered a senior, you'll have a good time on Wednesday. And Western Night is happening. It's on my list here. Someone help me with the date, Western Night. It's probably in your bulletin, November 14th. Western Night this year is a bring your own food and drinks of the non-fermented type, please. And we will have a great time of singing and interaction and a pie eating contest, and it's just a great time, and it's been 2 years since we did that, so we're looking forward to seeing you at Western Night. I'm going to pray for the offering now, if you'll join me in prayer. Lord, we love you so much, and we're just grateful to be together today, this morning, here at church, and all around this world that is joining us, streaming, as we think about our friends that are at home, as well as our missionaries across the globe, and our other friends at other churches that are joining us streaming. We're just glad for the representation that we have in with each other in you as a common bond that brings us together. Thank you for the time of worship that we had. May we continue to worship now as we dive into your word. Thank you for the words that you laid on Josh's heart as he leads us through that this morning. And we just pray for a good time together and an exciting and safe and fun time this fall as we get together with these different events. We pray these things in your son's name. Amen. Now, kids up through third grade, you are dismissed to children's church. Thanks for coming. Thanks for leaving.
Well, it's kind of nice to have some things to look forward to. I'm looking forward to Trunk or Treat. This is the first time that I'll ever do something like this. I'm glad it's on a Saturday night, so I can participate. I also look forward to taking lots of candy so that I can have that later. I'm looking forward to next Sunday. Next Sunday is November. Can you believe that we've already made it to November? This is the craziest and also the slowest year ever. And I'm also looking forward to the temperatures. Did you see the temperatures for this week? I mean, just having the clouds in the sky, it's like, oh, this is exciting. So I think we've made it. I think we're out of the woods, I hope. Well, I got a question for you, and I don't want you to spend too much time thinking about this, but we have a diversity of ages here, so this would be interesting. We're not going to actually ask you to respond, but how many jobs have you had in your life? How many jobs have you had in your life? I went online and I Googled this because I wanted to see what Google would say, and they say that there are 11.7 average jobs for someone between the ages of 18 and 48 years old, right? So in that span of time, people have typically about 12 or so jobs. And so after I looked at that, I thought, well, let me figure out how many I've had. And because I'm not anywhere near the age of 48, I got a little ways to go, but getting close. But I've had about 20 jobs in my life. Most of those are restaurants. In high school and in college, I had a lot of restaurant jobs, a lot of turnover with that. But that kind of crazy to think I've had that many jobs. Well, this is 2020. This has been a crazy year for so many people. A lot of people have been laid off from work because of the pandemic, and many people are getting back to work, and that means that they are applying for jobs. And one of the best ways to get hired on at a job is to be the most qualified. And that's going to look different depending on the kind of job that you are applying for. Certain jobs require a very specific degree. If you want to be a doctor, you better not have a major in history, okay? It's a very specific degree. Some have require specific experience. Some require specific availability. And some even like a specific personality. I mean, praise the Lord that there are jobs for extroverts and introverts out there, right? There's something for everyone. But if you meet the qualifications for a job, then what you do is you usually schedule an interview. And this is where it boils down to whether you're probably going to get the job or not. If you say the right things and you're the best qualified and you're a good fit and the interviewer likes you, you're most likely going to get the job. And most people go through this process several times in their life. Now, why am I talking about job interview? Well, because a lot of people think that getting into heaven is sort of like a job interview. Now, some of you have probably seen the cartoons. There's plenty of cartoons where you have someone in the clouds and they're meeting them at the pearly gates. And this is one of the cartoons. Sorry, your name and password don't match. You know, typical. That's kind of, all of us have way too many passwords. But a lot of people think, this is what it's going to be like for me to get into heaven. They're going to stand before someone, and usually the joke goes or the thought goes, I'm going to stand before Peter at the pearly gates, and he's going to ask me this question. Why should I let you into heaven? And most people throughout the world, throughout history, think, I need to have good enough reasons for them to let me into heaven. And that's what this life is about. Some people think that we have time to be prepared to answer that question, were we good enough to get into heaven? And we can answer that question and hopefully make it in. Well, our passage for today in Philippians, Paul is bound and determined to destroy that notion, not only for the Philippians, but for us as well. If you've been here and you've been listening to the sermons on Philippians, you know that a group of Judaizers, a group of people came in after Paul and they went to the city of Philippi and they said, that's fine that you believe in Jesus Christ for your salvation, but don't forget, you still have to follow the law. You have to be circumcised in order to be saved. In other words, they were like saying, you have to have this on your resume, otherwise you won't get into heaven. And that was circumcision. That was the first thing that they were talking about. It's like if you don't have that box checked off, then you will be denied and you will have no hope. And what Paul reveals to us in our passage for today is something that the world needs to hear. Your resume, my resume, it's worthless. It doesn't matter. It can't get us into heaven. The only thing that counts is what Jesus Christ did for you and your faith in him and what he has accomplished. Well, today what we're going to do is we're going to go through a history lesson in Philippians chapter 3. And the good thing is, for those of you familiar with the Bible, the Old Testament has the law, and we are no longer required to follow the law. Well, praise the Lord for that. But God did give us the law for several very good reasons. He gave us the law so that we can understand his holiness to us. He gave us the law to show us that you and I are unable to earn God's favor, but he also gave us the law because it contains lots of spiritual truths. The law is filled with so many ceremonies that were rich with symbolism that ultimately were pointing to what Christ was going to accomplish for us. That was the power of these rituals that were in the law. But in our passage for today, Paul is showing us his resume. He's saying, if there's anyone out there that thinks they have a good resume to get into heaven, mine's better. No one's is as good as mine. And what he does is he's showing this to us to prove that no one's resume is good enough. So let's look at our passage for today, Philippians chapter 3, and we're going to begin in verse 3. This is the passage that we looked at last week. He says, for we are the circumcision, he's speaking spiritually here, who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Verse 4. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also. If anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Now, that's a pretty bold statement. Paul is saying if there's anyone in the world who thinks that they're good enough by following the law to get into heaven, I have more reasons than they do to boast in what I've accomplished. And now he gives us his resume. Verse 5. He says, I was circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. And then he says, verse 7, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Now here in these couple verses, Paul shares with us seven important qualifications that he has. Now why did he choose seven? I don't know. Did he do that on purpose? Is it because this is kind of this, you know, total fulfillment? Seven is kind of the number of completion and fulfillment. Well, who knows? Some of you might understand already the significance of these seven qualifications that he lists here. But others of you, you might learn something for the first time. Yeah, that's what I love about this list. It kind of teaches us the foundation of our faith. We aren't Jews. At least I'm assuming that no one here is a descendant of Abraham. Maybe someone is. But God used the nation of Israel to bring salvation into the world. So learning more about Israel's history and traditions and rituals, it really gives us a better appreciation and understanding of our faith. But here are seven of the most important qualifications that Jews believed a person needed in order to be saved. But Paul ultimately teaches to us, it doesn't matter. So let's go through these seven, and hopefully you might learn something new today. This is what I love about being a pastor. I get to teach, hopefully, some people something new. The first qualification that he had, and I have this listed in order on your sermon notes, is this. He says that he was circumcised on the eighth day. Now, Paul begins with circumcision on his list of qualifications for a couple reasons. The first reason is because this was the subject that was being addressed in Philippi. But second reason is because this is also the first of the qualifications that any Jew would come across as they're born into the world. He tells us that not only was he circumcised, but that he was circumcised, and he gets very specific. I was an eighth-day circumcision child in strict obedience, in strict and perfect obedience to the law of Moses. Now, where does this come from? It comes from Leviticus 12, 1 and 2. This is what Moses told the people to do. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the people of Israel, saying, if a woman conceives and bears a male child, then she shall be unclean 7 days. As the time of her menstruation, she shall be unclean. And on the eighth day, the flesh of his foreskin shall be circumcised. Now, as time went on, the Jewish men would eventually be circumcised at some point in their lives. Or if there was a proselyte, a Gentile, who came to faith in the God of Israel, he would be circumcised later on in life. But Paul underwent this ritual in the most pure and strict moment, 8 days after his birth. Paul was not circumcised on the fifth day, or the tenth day, or 1 month later. It was specifically on the eighth day. He was a Jew by birth, and he and his family followed each and every ritual from the very beginning. From the moment he was born, his family had him following every single rule that the Israelites had given to him. But Paul indicates that in this list of qualifications that salvation is not by any ritual. I think we all need to hear this. Listen, there is not a single ritual that you and I can do that is going to earn us God's favor or get us into heaven. Circumcision cannot save you. Baptism cannot save you. Communion cannot save you. Now, there's value in these rituals because they are revealing to us a work that Christ did, but they can't save us by doing those things alone. And so that's why he lists this on the top of his qualifications. The next qualification, he says, that he is of the people of Israel. And this is probably aimed at his opposition. The Judaizers that came in, there's a good chance that some of them may have been Gentile proselytes. They came to the Jewish faith, which would make sense why they're pushing circumcision so hard, because they were trying to get other people to do that as well. But Paul says, by birth, he is part of God's chosen people. The Israelites were special. God chose them to usher salvation into the world. There are several places in the Old Testament where God tells Israel, you are special. You're special not because you did anything to be special. You're special because I chose for you to be special. One place he says this is in Amos. Amos 3, verses 1 and 2. It says, "Hear the word of the Lord has spoken against you, O people of Israel, against the whole family that I brought up out of the land of Egypt." Verse 2, "You only have I known of all the families of the earth. Therefore I will punish you for all your iniquities." He says, you only, you're the only family of people that I have known like I do with you. Listen, God did not select two nations to reveal himself to the world. He did not select 3 or 5 or 10. He selected one. He selected the descendants of Abraham. Do any of you have a famous relative? Like if you go back in your timeline, you're related to someone famous, you know, someone who did something important. My mom said, I think this, and I'm going to get this all mixed up, but on my grandma's side, my mom's mom's side, I'm somehow related to Abraham Lincoln. That doesn't get me any favors or anything, and I don't even know if it's true, but this is what Paul was able to do. As he's going out and he's talking to these Gentiles, they know of Israel, they know of the Jewish faith. He could take a scroll from what we call the Old Testament or the Torah in Genesis, and Paul could literally open it up and start reading about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And Paul probably knew exactly which great-great-great-great-great-grandfather they were to him. He was a direct descendant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so he lists this in his qualifications. You think that you're qualified to earn God's favor? Even though you can't. I have more reasons. I am of the people of Israel. But he tells us this so that we know that salvation is not by our ancestry. It's not by our race. Third qualification he gives, he's getting a little more specific now. He says, I'm of the tribe of Benjamin. And so we are thinking, well, what's so special about Benjamin? I'm glad you asked, because I'm going to tell you. Well, the Jews would know about this. Jacob, whose name was later turned into Israel, which means wrestles with God, Jacob had 12 sons through 4 wives. Yes, you can imagine that led to a lot of problems. If you want to read about those problems, which there are many, read the book of Genesis. He had 4 wives. Actually, 2 were his wives, and then they were the concubines of his wife. They were his concubines. But 2 of them, of the 4, were sisters. Yeah, talk about problems. That led to more problems. Rachel and Leah. Rachel was his favorite, and he made no bones about it. He was very clear that Rachel was his favorite wife. She only had 2 children. Joseph, who was sold into slavery, and he's the reason why Jacob and the family moved down to Egypt, and they were eventually led back by Moses. But Rachel had 2 sons, Joseph, and the other son was Benjamin. And Benjamin was the youngest. And not only was he the youngest, Rachel died after giving birth to Benjamin. So Benjamin was a very special one of the 12 sons of Israel. And Paul was in the direct line of Benjamin, the youngest of the sons and one of the 2 favorites of Israel. Well, here there's more fun facts about Benjamin. Let me give these to you. Benjamin was also the only one of the 12 brothers who was born in the Promised Land. So he was special in that way. He was the only one of the 12. Saul, who was the first king of Israel, well, guess which tribe he happened to be born into? Benjamin. All right? Okay, you kind of see where this is going. Mordecai, who was responsible for almost saving the Jews from extinction in the book of Esther, he was of the tribe of Benjamin. And as the Jews entered the Promised Land, God gave them each an allotment of land. And the most important of all the cities in Israel was Jerusalem. Well, guess which territory Jerusalem was in? Benjamin. And so Benjamin was this noble royal line, lineage of the 12 sons of Israel. And so Paul is saying, not only was I circumcised on the 8th day, not only was I a direct descendant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but I'm also of the tribe of Benjamin. Now, if we notice, these first 3 qualifications, Paul had absolutely nothing to do with them. Okay, he got lucky. Okay, just by chance, he was able to claim these for himself. Now, the next 4, he goes on to talk about the qualifications that were made based on his decisions and life choices. 4th qualification is this. He said he was a Hebrew of Hebrews. Not just a Jew. He was a Hebrew of Hebrews. Well, this is probably best understood to mean that his upbringing would have been very strict and that his family would have followed all the laws and rituals without error. And this would be even more impressive because Paul did not grow up in the land of Israel. He grew up in a foreign city called Tarsus. And so they would have to have fought off the Greek influence in that city. It's, you know, wherever you live somewhere, it's kind of easy to just kind of fit into the culture of that society, wherever you live. Well, they were Jews, and their way of life they thought was superior, and it was special, and it was sacred. And so they had to go out of their way to separate and distinguish themselves from the surrounding pagan people. And not only did he live this way growing up, but when he was old enough, he moved to Jerusalem, and he studied under one of the most famous rabbis of all the rabbis ever in the history of Israel, by a man named Gamaliel. So he was a Hebrew of Hebrews. He really adapted and adopted every single Jewish culture and way of living. In Acts chapter 26, this is where Paul is trying to appeal and eventually get his way to Rome, where he wrote the book of Philippians. And he's standing before a king, King Agrippa. And he's giving his defense because the Jews wanted King Agrippa to release them so that they could eventually kill him. But in Acts chapter 26, Paul is talking about his life. Listen to how he is a Hebrew of Hebrews. He says this, Acts 26. Then Agrippa said to Paul, "You may speak in your defense." So Paul, gesturing with his hand, started his defense. "I am fortunate, King Agrippa, that you are the one hearing my defense today against all the accusations made by the Jewish leaders. For I know you are an expert in all Jewish customs and controversies. Now please listen to me patiently." In verse 4, he says this. "As the Jewish leaders are well aware, I was given a thorough Jewish training from my earliest childhood among my own people and in Jerusalem." Now notice he says, leaders are well aware. Listen, Paul was very well known among all the Jewish leaders. Paul was famous, and no one questioned his upbringing or his commitment to his Jewish heritage. And Paul tells us in his list on this resume, that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how Jewish or Hebrew he was. It doesn't get him into heaven. And not only was he a Hebrew of Hebrews, but he went to the next level up, and he was part of the most committed of Hebrews. And his fifth qualification is this. He says, "As to the law, a Pharisee." Going to the next verse in Acts 26, verse 5 says, "And if they would admit it, they know that I have been a member of the Pharisees, the strictest sect of our religion." Not only was he a Hebrew of Hebrews, he was the most strict. He pursued the Jewish heritage to an extreme. He was so zealous for the law that he joined the most intense and strict group that there was in all of Israel. And to become a Pharisee was to reach the highest level of devout legal Judaism. Not only was he a Pharisee, but guess what? His father was a Pharisee. So each time Paul is giving his resume, he's going to the next level. You know, it is estimated at Paul's time that there were probably only 6,000 Pharisees, but they had the most influence on the people. To be a Pharisee was to be a member of a very elite and influential, highly respected group of men who devoted their entire life to knowing the law, to interpreting the law, and to defending and guarding the law. He was that intense. He was that committed to his faith. But even more than his commitment to his faith, he also had a passion that was unrivaled. And passion to the Jews was very important. And so that's why he says his sixth qualification was this. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church. Jews valued zeal. They were zealous. They were crazy. They were zealous. And the thing about zeal is a two-sided coin. When you say that you have zeal, it means that you love something and you hate something. All right? That's what zeal means. And when they said that they had zeal for the Lord, it means that they loved the Lord and they hated what offended the Lord. And so before Paul came to understand who Jesus truly was, Paul saw the followers of Jesus as enemies of God and a group that would lead people astray and lead them away from the law of God and Moses. So he was so passionate about what he believed that he pursued Christians and he persecuted them. you stay in Acts chapter 26, you go to verse 9, he's still talking to King Agrippa, and this is what he says. Acts 26, beginning in verse 9. He says, I myself was convinced. Convinced, that's a heavy word. He was sincerely committed to what he believed. He says, I myself was convinced that I ought to do many things in opposing the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And I did so in Jerusalem. I not only locked up many of the saints in prison after receiving authority from the chief priests, but when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. And I punished them often in all the synagogues and tried to make them blaspheme. And in raging fury against them, I persecuted them even to foreign cities. But Paul tells us now that his passion and his zeal was wrong, and his sincerity could not save him. Now, before we go on to the next and the last qualification, I just want us to notice something here. Up to this point in time, with each qualification, it's like he's taking a step up this ladder, and he's distinguishing himself from huge groups of people that could also go up the ladder. I want to use kind of an analogy here that a lot of people are talking about today to kind of think about Paul when he says that no one had more reason to boast than him. In professional sports, everyone always has the debate, who is the greatest? And maybe in the one sport where people actually can have this debate and it kind of makes sense, it's professional basketball in the NBA. And there's a debate going on, who is the greatest NBA player of all time? And usually the answer is Michael Jordan. But lately, people have been saying another name. Some of you might have heard the name LeBron James. Well, for those of you who have been paying attention to sports during the pandemic, they did have the NBA championships in the bubble in Orlando. LeBron James won the championship with the Lakers. He now has 4 championships to Michael Jordan's 6. But LeBron James has 4 on 3 different teams. Now, I'm not here to tell you, because I really don't care, who the greatest NBA player of all time is, but I want to give you an example to understand how extremely significant and rare it is for anyone to be considered the best in the world at anything. Listen, if we all have an incredibly more likely chance of winning the lottery and getting struck by lightning than we will to be the best in the world at any one thing. All right? So I want to use basketball as an example. And this does relate to Paul and how he has distinguished himself from everyone else. All right, I don't know how many of you ever played basketball or like basketball, but to play basketball in high school, let's start in high school. To be on the high school team in basketball, you need to be pretty good. All right, there's only one team, there's only one varsity team, and there's only 5 starters. And so you have to be one of the 5 best players in your entire high school to be on your high school basketball team. You gotta be pretty good, right? But there's a lot of people playing high school basketball. A lot of people. So if you're really good, you might get recruited to play college basketball. And the statistics are that 3% of high school basketball players, only 3%, are going to be on a team in the college ranks. All right? That's just to be on a team. Not to start, but just to be on a team. And then if you're playing college ball and if you're really good, then your hope is that you're going to get drafted into the NBA. But only 1% of college basketball players are drafted to be on a team in the NBA. All right, now I'm going to give you some numbers, and eventually if I give you too many numbers, it gets confusing. But if we go back to high school, and if we look at all the high school players, only 3 out of every 10,000 high school basketball players will be drafted onto an NBA team. Those are slim odds. You have to be exceptional to be drafted. And then as soon as you're drafted and you make it to the NBA, you have to be that much better than everyone else to be a starter on your team. And then to make the All-Star, you have to be exceptionally good. There's only 450 roster spots in the NBA. There's 30 teams, typically 15 roster spots, but only 24 people make it to the All-Star game, meaning only 5% of the best of the best of the best players in the world make it to the All-Star. And then to be considered the best in the world that has ever seen, you have to win multiple All-Star, beyond multiple All-Stars. So of all the thousands and hundreds of thousands of people, for anyone to be considered the best is extremely rare and difficult. But each time a basketball player makes it from one level to the next, from high school to college to MBA, they are distinguishing themselves from thousands and thousands and thousands of people. Now, I want you to think about this from Paul's perspective. In every area of Paul's life, he took that next step, and he distinguished himself from hundreds of thousands of people. He says that if anyone has reason to boast, he has more. It's quite possible that Paul has the best resume of all time of every human being, or at least he's in the discussion of that. And finally, he says as a summary, as to righteousness under the law, I was blameless. Now, this is not Paul's way of saying that he never sinned, but instead he was probably saying that no one was better than him. Now, think about this. When it comes to Paul's ancestry, it was perfect. When it comes to him participating in the rituals, he was perfect. When it came to him understanding the law, he was perfect. When it came to his passion for the law, it was perfect. Every box was checked on his resume. No one could look at his life and say, hey, you're doing really good, but you have one area of weakness. He had no weaknesses. He was better than everyone. He was the perfect Jew. He had the perfect resume. He was a shoe-in, first ballot Hall of Famer, and guaranteed to get into heaven. And then he says, verse 7, this is on your notes. Then he says this, of this perfect resume that he has, he says, but whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. If the best person ever says his resume meant nothing, then what does that mean for you and for me? If it meant nothing to him, not just nothing, all of those human accomplishments were actually negative. They were a loss. His life could be summarized now by lost time, lost energy, and lost pride. And the great thing about the Apostle Paul, which I'm so grateful we have this, there was a very specific moment in time when Paul thought and realized that all these things that he had going for them meant nothing and that he was wrong. That moment in time is recorded. Let's read about it. This is in Acts chapter 9. And I'm reading from the New Living Translation. I just like how it words this phrase here. It says, meanwhile, Saul, who is Paul, that was probably more of his Gentile name, or his Jewish name, Saul was uttering threats with every breath and was eager to kill the Lord's followers. Okay, this is at the peak of his Jewishness. So he went to the high priest. He requested letters addressed to the synagogues in Damascus, asking for their cooperation in the arrest of any followers of the way he found there. He wanted to bring them, both men and women, back to Jerusalem in chains. Verse 3. As he was approaching Damascus on this mission, a light from heaven suddenly shone down around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you, Lord? Saul said, and he will never forget this. And the voice replied, I am Jesus, the one you are persecuting. I wonder how long he stayed on the ground. In that moment, what kind of thoughts do you think went through Paul's mind? Here he's been persecuting the followers of Jesus, and Jesus meets him on the road, obviously alive. And I bet Paul, because he knew the law so well, he was thinking, if this is Jesus, then I've been wrong. And I bet he was going through certain prophecies thinking, could Jesus have possibly fulfilled this prophecy? And yeah, I guess he did. And then going through another prophecy, yeah, Jesus fulfilled that. And getting to the point where he's thinking, oh no. How many oh no's did Paul think in that moment on the road? And how many aha's did Paul have in that moment when everything changed in that moment? And then we get to verse 6. And Jesus says to him, now get up and go into the city and you will be told what to do. The men with Saul stood speechless, for they heard the sound of someone's voice but saw no one. Saul picked himself up off the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he was blind. So his companions led him by the hand to Damascus. Listen, that is the worst and the best moment in Saul's life up to that point everything changed. He realized Jesus is the one. Jesus is the hope of Israel. Jesus is the hope of the world. And since that moment, Paul has devoted all of his energy and passion and drive into helping us see who Jesus Christ is as well. You know, earlier in Acts, this is right after the ascension of Jesus, Peter, who believed Jesus was the Messiah, he made this huge statement to all the Jews. And I wonder if Paul was there and he heard Peter say what he did. I'm going to read for you from Acts 4, verses 10 through 12. Peter's standing up and he's defending who Jesus is, and he makes this accusation to all the Jews. And I really wonder, and it doesn't tell us who was there, but I wonder if Paul was listening to Peter's words. Peter says this, verse 10. Let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. They healed someone. That's why they were in this situation. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And then he says, verse 12, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. People today, 2,000 years later, are still living their life thinking that there's an interview at the end of their life. People are living in such a way that they can impress each other and impress whoever they're going to meet, they think, at the pearly gates. And from a human standpoint, a lot of people have done a lot of good things. But like after some job interview, you know what happens? It's not always the most qualified person who gets the job. You know who gets the job? It's the friend of the owner, right? That's usually how it works. And the saying is so true. It's not what you know. It's who you know. And when it comes to salvation, it's not what you did. It's what Jesus did. That's how we are saved. And when we focus on creating an impressive resume, a list of human accomplishments that value in this life, have value in this life, we are going to miss the real life that God is calling us to. Next week, as we continue on in Philippians, Paul is going to share with us the greatness of knowing Christ. And if there's anyone who understands the greatness of laying aside all of his past accomplishments and understanding the hope and the future that Jesus is offering us, it's Paul. But before we get there and before we close, I have to ask all of you this question, whether you're here today or you're online. What about you? Are you right now busy trying to build your resume? Listen, if Paul couldn't do it, you can't do it. If Paul was not good enough to get into heaven by his works, by following all the rules, and he realizes it's not me, it has to be what Jesus Christ did, then why would any of us waste another second trying to impress God when we can't? And all we need to do is say, I am a sinner, and I believe that you sent Jesus to die on the cross for my sins. So I want to give that offer to you right now. Anyone online, anyone here today, if everyone would just bow their heads and close their eyes. In this moment, you can stop trying to accomplish what you can never accomplish. You can place your faith in the finished work of Christ. And all you need to do is pray to God, and he will hear you say this. Say, dear Lord, dear God, I know I am a sinner. And I know my sins separate me from you. Thank you for sending Jesus, your son, to die on the cross for my sins. And thank you for raising him from the dead to give me the hope of eternal life. At this moment, Father, I place my faith in Jesus alone for my salvation. And if you said that prayer ever in your life or today, right now, that is your resume. It's Christ's work. And we can praise God for that. Let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, I thank you so very much. As we read through this passage here in Philippians, it's clear. So many people are ruining their lives trying to build a resume that's worthy to present to someone at the pearly gates, and that's not even how it works. And they're foolish. They're doing this for nothing. And yet you give us someone like the Apostle Paul, who is probably had a better resume than anyone, any other human being ever of all time. And he tells us clearly, if I can't do it, you can't, so stop trying. Lord, this is the message of grace. This is the message of hope. And I thank you so much for not giving us the responsibility of earning your pleasure, but in your grace and mercy, you did that for us. And so, Lord, today, I acknowledge as a church, we acknowledge as a church, it's only by what you've done for us that gives us the hope of eternal life. Help us to rest on that truth and help us to be clear to the world around us that that is their hope as well. Lord, we love you. Thank you for the finished work of Christ. And we look forward to everything else that he has promised for us and what is the surpassing greatness of knowing him. We love you. Thank you, Lord. We pray all these things in Christ's most excellent name. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us if you would? Sing one last song before we are dismissed to go home. Get some lunch.
I cast my life like ashes on the waves and leave behind all of my selfish ways. My past is gone, now all that's left is grace. To live is Christ, to die is gain. I have been crucified with Christ, it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. I have a second chance in life, my future's open wide. But Christ lives.